Everybody's talking at me. I don't hear a word they're saying. Only the echoes of my mind.
Hey everybody, welcome to Pizzacast number 6. Today we're going to talk about the new Tomb Raider game. It's raising a few eyebrows for being kind of sexist. The Zero issues of DC that they're coming out with, was it this month?
September.
September. That's not even close to this month.
No. It might be if you're listening in the future.
Yeah. Which, if you are, how is it? How's the future?
Are there flying cars?
Please say yes. That and more, maybe we'll talk about the Great Gatsby trailer. Pizzacast, the official podcast of Pizza Extreme Team. Go. Pizza go. That was the signal to start.
Okay.
That's the best you're going to get out of me.
Sounds good. All right. Well, before we get going with our news topics, is there anything you guys have been doing this week?
Not really. Yeah. Unless you count working is cool.
Yeah. And I don't.
I got Dragon's Dogma, that game, in the mail. I haven't played it a lot because I've been working to gauge whether it's good or not. But it doesn't seem like it's going to be that great.
Hmm.
It's like Capcom's take on Skyrim.
Okay.
Which, of course, Capcom's a Japanese company that makes mostly Japanese-style games.
Right.
And Skyrim is a very Western game. So yeah. It's just like them trying to make games that are made in America. And it's like, why would you do, the games you were making before were already good.
Yeah, that's weird.
Yeah. Everything's all like brown and serious and
like sepia tones, and like that's how you know we're being, you know.
No, it's just everything's dirty and brown.
Oh, okay.
And the people are kind of ugly, and like, where's
kind
the cool okay, they're very ugly. Well, they're less ugly than Skyrim people are. I mean, their hair doesn't look like wet yarn dipped in acrylic paint. They had
that dog in Skyrim.
There's a dog in Skyrim that just looked like a horrible monster Muppet. but Capcom games had so much style going on, like Devil May Cry. Like, that's crazy style. And now this is what they want to do, is just make, you know, lame Western games. Not that I don't like Western games. There's a lot of great Western games. But yeah. Stick to what you're good at, Capcom. Or make this Western game, but put your Japanese twist on it that I like.
Right.
That would be good.
Yeah.
Because that's the main thing I don't like about Skyrim, is it doesn't have any sort of artistic style other than kind of real.
Dirty.
Yeah, dirty Nordic men. Which makes it sound really gay. The women aren't even attractive. I've never seen an attractive woman in an Elder Scrolls game ever. Even Fallout, like, it barely, like, the closest it gets is Moira. She's about the cutest, and she's more character cute than physically. Yeah, which I guess is better. I mean, if you're gonna write a character, I'd rather play a game with that character than hot lady. But I don't know. That's what I've thought of Dragon's Dogma so far. I'll probably write a review of it. But then I said that about Max Payne, and I still haven't.
Still do it.
Yeah. What's up with that?
I just liked it so much that I don't want to write about it. Like, it's kind of like, I'll just be like, yay. Rah, 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 Max Payne is great. It's the same thing why I never reviewed Mario 3D Land, because I loved it more than anything. I rarely play all the way through. Well, I usually play through the storylines in a game, but I'll never, like, get every little bobble and trinket. Mario 3D Land, I did. I did not stop till I got everything.
Oh, wow. Wow.
It's that good.
Cool. Very cool.
So, somebody else go. I've jabbered about video games enough.
You've been up to, Sam?
Well, haven't really been watching a whole lot. Just been kind of, you know, working a lot too. But Oh, here comes the dog. Say hi, Jake. He doesn't like the mic.
He jumped down into, like, play stance, though.
Yeah.
I know. He wanted to play with the mic.
Yep.
With the viewers.
I know. All right. Bye, Jake.
Yeah, he's leaving.
Yeah. So anyways, yeah, I haven't really been doing a whole lot, but over the weekend, Kelly and I went to a convention in Westerville, Ohio. The convention was called Science Fiction Festival 2012. Not very descriptive or fancy, but you know, that's okay. We found it in the local paper. They did an article on this, the store. It is an actual honest-to-God Star Trek store. I mean, you know, most comic shops, hobby shops have, you know, your comics, you have your geek stuff, your sci-fi stuff. This place is just Star Trek.
They don't even have like a little bit of anything else?
Well, they have a little bit of Star Wars, and they have one podium of Harry Potter.
You'd think that there's some Doctor Who in there, but
no, there wasn't really any Doctor Who. It was almost entirely Star Trek. And they tried. I don't want to be that guy that savages this thing, but let me put it to you this way. When I go to someone who is not into geek stuff and I tell them, hey, I'm going to a comic book convention, this convention that we went to is what I imagine they picture in their heads. Oh, God. There was nothing there. There was maybe 15, 20 people, including the people doing stuff. It was all in one big half a warehouse that they boarded off. And it wasn't really even a half a warehouse, just like a little shed kind of thing. Oh, no. There were four tables set up. One was of the USS Maximilian, which was a ship that, you know, this is its 20th anniversary of being launched or something. There was a table that was completely empty except for a photo album of past science fiction festivals with the page turn.
I can't get over how generic that is.
Oh, you would, if you were there, you would say, yep, this is Science Fiction Festival 2012. But anyways, it had a photo album with the pages turned to one page where they had that one year where Sulu showed up. They had a table that was just a diorama of space. like a kid's elementary school, like
science fair,
yeah, of the solar system. And a table in the back running VHS copies of the new Doctor Who on a tiny TV.
Where do you get VHS copies?
He taped them off TV.
Oh, yeah, I
guess. Yeah. It gets better. The site or the article boasted, you know, a robot building competition as one of the big things with a prize or whatever. All that was a box of Legos.
Was it even like Mindstorms?
No, they were just Legos. It was just a tub of Legos. I mean, granted, there were a ton of Legos. I mean, I could have built some cool stuff with that. But no, they were just Legos in a tub, in like a big bin for people to play with.
Wow.
They also had a panel section. It was 15 chairs set up off to the side on the other end of this shed. About three people were sitting there. They were watching Amazing Randy, the 12-year-old magician.
Oh, no.
Yep.
The only thing worse than a magician is a 12-year-old.
Oh, man. Yep. And it was very clear that his assistant was his dad.
Oh. His beautiful assistant.
Yes.
Dad.
But oh my God! And then we paid $2 to get in. So I mean that was okay. And we got free iron-on patches. I got a pretty sweet Borg cube. I tell you what, guys. but no. Then we went to check out the store, and walking into the store, you would say, "Yep, they would throw a science fiction festival 2012." I mean, they had a lot of stuff. I mean, it was okay. It was neat. But I mean, as culturally accepted geeks and nerds and sci-fi folks and Star Trek people are now, think of how it was about 15 years ago.
It was like stepping back in time.
It was like stepping back in time. Oh, God. A couple of good things that did come out of it, though, in that little area, there was also next to the Star Trek store shed, there was a toy store shed. And it was pretty cool. The guy goes and buys like Lego sets that Meyer's about ready to get rid of for super cheap and resells them. And that was pretty cool. He also had all the little blind bag minifigs opened up on the wall so you can actually see what you're getting. That was pretty cool. We also went into probably the worst comic book shop I've ever been into in my entire life. Wow. It was a house that they had reconfigured into a store, a two-story house with shit just laying all over the place. And I don't mean just comics and stuff. Like – empty pizza boxes, like bags of cans. I mean, they were trying really hard. And I'm sure that back when that was the only shop in town, that would have been an excellent shop. There's actually another shop that opened up about 6 months ago that is phenomenal and makes me angry because they have a whole bunch of Silver Age comics, but the guy knows how to price them correctly. Uh-huh. So if you want anything, you actually have to pay the regular price for them. But whatever, it's a really cool store. But this one I'm talking about, this house, it was a mess. It was the worst comic shop I have ever walked into.
It's like comic books and garbage.
Yeah. Yeah. But I got to hand it to them. They did have a TV that was playing Mystery Science Theater on a loop. So at least they knew, at least they had some idea. And the people in there seemed very nice. But it was a mess.
You should have took pictures of all
this
stuff.
I felt bad. Oh, yeah. I mean, I felt bad. I didn't want to,
it would just end up a really mean-spirited.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, I probably sound pretty mean-spirited now because of what I've been saying. But, I mean, they were trying. They tried very hard. And I'm sure but once upon a time.
It just wasn't enough.
Yeah, right. Exactly. It just wasn't enough. But we did find also in Westerville some other little shops. Like there's an old antique store that specializes in 70s stuff, which was pretty awesome. They had the old Flying V. Like it looked like the body of a Flying V guitar table, like the old 70s. Awesome. Like, yeah, all that cool stuff and a couple of good coffee shops. It was weird. The town has like two of everything. Like in the main drag, there were two coffee shops. There were two antique stores. They're like two of everything. I don't get it.
But there was only one science fiction festival 2012.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, we've been to some bad cons. But this is the first time I can safely say I probably won't be back. I mean, it was sad. I mean, you guys can hear how much it pains me to say this stuff because they were trying. They really were. But man, it just wasn't good at all. So,
yeah, I wish we would have known about Colossal Con before.
I wish we would have, too. No, that seemed pretty cool.
I mean, it looked kind of like Ohio Con, but better. It's Ohio Con at a water park. Mm.
You bored, go.
Yeah, like I said in the article, if you get bored of looking at hug pillows and PVC figurines, you can go to the water park.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, that looked like a ton of fun. That's one I think I might check out. Yeah, we might check out next year. Yeah, for sure.
Maybe we'll get a booth.
Yeah.
Apparently there was a board game con in Columbus like a couple weekends ago.
Really?
Somebody I work with went to it. And you could go there and you could try out board games.
Oh, that's cool.
And they sold all kinds of board games. Like, I totally would have went to that if I would have known.
Yeah, yeah.
It was cheap to get. It is con season.
It is,
it.
Yeah. Huh.
But I forget what it was called, but it sounded really cool. Because I like board games, but I never get to play them, and they're also expensive.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. All right, well, I think that's all I got. You guys got anything else?
No, we could probably go to break.
Okay, yeah, let's go ahead and go to break, and when we come back, we'll talk about some news stuff.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. I find it very, very easy to be true. I find myself alone when each day is through.
And we're back, and we're going to talk about the new Tomb Raider game.
Because recently there was an article on Kotaku with the, I think it was the executive producer of the game or something, that was like, that really didn't sit well with me.
Yeah?
Like, it just seemed wrong. He was talking about how this game is one where we're really, you know, knocking Lara Croft down and making her struggle, and you want to protect her. And I'm like, that doesn't sound right at all.
No.
He's the one that goes around punching tigers and stuff.
Fighting endangered animals.
Yeah, this doesn't sound like a strong female character at all.
Well, it's supposed to be about her becoming strong, and you help her become strong. But there's also an attempted rape in it.
Yeah, I watched that trailer for it, and that was not something I would want to invest any amount of time in. At all.
Yeah, like, I was excited about the game at first, like the first trailer, which didn't seem like torture porn.
Yeah.
But like now it's like, it just looks so wrong. Like, I'm not even interested anymore.
Women don't need, like, you know, rape to become strong. Like, they can just decide one day, you know, okay, I'm gonna be stronger. Yeah. That's not necessary.
That's why the Hunger Games did female characters right. I mean, nobody tried to rape Katniss, and she's still awesome.
She just, you know, stepped up.
Yeah, I gotta be strong, I gotta step up, and she did.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Well, see, what we don't know is that every time she's not on scene, constant attempted rape. Just constant, one after the other.
You just cut it out of the book.
That's right, yeah.
It's also because it's probably a mature title.
We gotta make it mature.
Yeah.
But, like, why do we want a white knight Lara Croft? I want to protect it. No.
No, you're not. No. That's not.
I want to raid some tombs.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, I want to be badass and, you know, swing around on these vines or whatever. Yeah,
climb a wall.
I don't want to protect her.
Yeah.
Make her do awesome stuff.
And there's nothing wrong with building up to being strong, but you don't need to, like,
knock her down
constantly.
It's like this weird oppressive
it's like
power fantasy.
It's like the opposite of
it's the opposite of what Tomb Raider originally was dominant Lara Croft, you know, domineering over everything around her, and now we've got passive, weak Lara Croft being dominated by everything.
Yeah, I mean, it's like they took that trailer, it's like they took like the worst bits of every cutscene. It's like, oh no, there's a plane that's falling on top of me, and then this guy is trying to rape me, and then more gunfire, and I get tied up again.
It's like they're just going completely the wrong way. And I can understand wanting to make it different than the originals, but they're doing it wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I wasn't even, you know, actively looking to be offended by the game.
No, we were actually before that, we thought it looked pretty
cool. Yeah, I was interested in it.
Survival, the Lara Croft, it's pretty cool.
And maybe, yeah, that sounds like a great game, right? Like Survivor Man Lara Croft, like Bear Grylls Lara Croft Adventure. Sounds like a good game, but
yeah.
No, maybe it's just this, maybe it's the PR. Maybe they're spinning it wrong. They got some sexist idiot. You know, maybe this executive producer guy was just a douche.
That's what I'm hoping. I imagine here within the next couple of weeks they'll have another trailer that paints the game in a much better light. Like, it shows the second half of all of those cutscenes that they put in the first trailer, where she's like coming, like striving above, like, my plane's falling. Oh no! But here's in the second trailer. But I'm gonna make it anyways. This guy's trying to rape me, but then I punched him.
Like, I'll still try it when it comes out.
Sure.
It'll be a good review either way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I was surprised that people aren't more upset about it, too.
I don't know.
You don't see a lot of stuff written about it. Like, it should be a big deal. It should be a big internet deal. Can't see my air quotes around internet deal.
Yeah.
Like, every time Catwoman is in a suggestive pose, it becomes an internet deal.
Yeah, right. Speaking of which...
Yeah, let's segue into the DC Zero issues.
Yeah. DC announced that in September. September's the 1 year... mark of the New 52 project that they're doing.
It's already been a year.
It's been a year, yeah, I know. That's scary to think about. But they're going to do a handful... Each issue is going to have a zero issue, meaning it's a story that takes place prior to the first issue from a year ago, except for where it doesn't. Because some of those zero issues actually also end the series somehow, and some of them take place in present but also in the past. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Yeah, exactly. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
You thought the number ones were the most important? Now there's zeros. Go buy them.
Yeah, right.
Also, speaking of sexist Catwoman poses, the zero Catwoman pose is horrible. And not even from the sexist standpoint, it's just poorly drawn.
A lot of those zero issue covers are not good. I mean, yeah, Catwoman is terrible. She looks like the strong female characters... things from Kate Beaton and
like exactly
with the boobs and the butt at the same time. Yeah, but no, a lot of those covers are just not good. The cover for Justice League has Shazam on it, and it's the worst looking piece of trash I've ever seen. It's like he's grimace. It's like Shazam, Captain Marvel.
Yeah,
because fuck Shazam, it's Captain Marvel. He's standing there. He's like ripping through the cover, like the original first issue cover. And it's like he's like grimacing with his teeth sticking out and his gums are huge. And it's like he's smiling, but also like angry. Like he's like,
I'm angry, Cappy.
Yeah. And it's the first full shot of the costume that I've seen. And it looks terrible. I mean, it looks like the old Captain Marvel, kind of, but it has ribbing on the shoulders and like down here on the stomach and the chest for no reason.
It's for her pleasure.
Yeah, it's exactly. Yeah, right. Yeah. But and like his logo, it doesn't look like a logo, the lightning bolt insignia. It looks like a hole in his chest that is spewing lightning blood out of his chest.
The blood of a lightning bolt.
Yeah. It is just God awful.
For a minute there before you said it was spewed, I thought he just had a lightning bolt shape cut out in the front of his suit.
I'm surprised he doesn't. Like the male power girl.
Yeah. What were we going to say about...
Rosalyn, I can't say it.
Her Tumblr?
Yeah, she...
With the Catwoman picture?
Yes.
She drew a picture of Catwoman... For like in parody of that awful cover of Catwoman like licking her own butt like a cat, like with her foot in the air, and I think underneath it said, "You want a pose that shows off both her tits and her ass? Here you go. You're welcome."
Yeah, that makes
more sense, I would think.
Right, they might as well. I mean, some DC exec probably saw that and went, "Oh, that's hot.
That's a good idea. Hire, no, don't hire her because she's a woman."
Yeah, right.
Get a male artist on that right away.
Hey, Rob Liefeld, you're good at drawing people with no skeletal structure whatsoever. Come on in here.
We need you to do this.
Can you do this, but also make it not possible by a human?
Also put some pouches in there?
Yes. Oh my god. Oh, yeah. But anyways, this zero issue thing makes no sense. It really doesn't. DC did zero. It's another attempt of them mining old ideas. Because back in the, I want to say mid-90s, I'm not certain, I want to say mid-90s, they did an event called Zero Hour where all time was being consumed because Green Lantern went crazy and decided he wanted to remake the universe. When he redid the universe, it created a zero issue for every issue, which took place some point in time before the first issue, but also tied into the 0 hour event. And that made sense. This makes no sense.
It's like, we can do it. I mean,
yeah, it just makes numbering ridiculous because you don't know whether you want to put it in as the first issue in your box before the one or like at where it goes. Plus, like I said, three series are ending to make way for four new ones in September. The ones that are ending are Captain Atom, which I'm kind of sad about, but I can understand. Resurrection Man, which has always been a character favorite of mine, but it's not pulling the sales. Justice League International is ending a few months early. It's like, I think that's either ending this month or next month. And oh God, what was the fourth one? Voodoo, which no one reads.
I read a couple of the first ones. It's pretty ridiculous.
Oh yeah. Alien Stripper.
Yeah.
Alien Stripper Spy. Yeah. You think everyone would read it, but no. No.
Maybe they should have named it something more appealing.
Like Alien Stripper Spy.
Yeah. I had no idea what it was. It was like,
yeah,
I don't know. I've never heard about this, so I'll
Voodoo was one of the Wildstorm Comics characters that was folded in during the big redo. But that, so, you know, that had that going against it, too.
They're not knocking off Suicide Squad?
No, they're not knocking off Suicide Squad. They're not knocking off Deathstroke or Grifter or any of the books that should be ending. Because they're going on straight sales. And because people fucking love Rob Liefeld, or love to see the train wreck of Rob Liefeld, all of his books have higher sales than some of these halfway decent ones. God. Not saying that Captain Atom is halfway decent, because it's really not. They're getting into some weird Hindu stuff in it right now, and it's just not making sense. But, you know, it's a shame. Although, I am kind of looking forward to a couple of the books that are being released. One of them is tying in with is another Batman book, which will make...
How many are there?
Well,
a lot.
Well, I mean, there are 25%... As of September, 25% of DC's output are going to be Batman-related titles.
Oh, my God.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I guess there's a Batman movie coming out.
Yeah, but you see, but this character isn't even... It's not even a Batman character. There's a storyline going on right now called The Court of Owls, which is taking place in all the Batman books about this crazy cult of owl people that have trained mind-controlled super assassins with healing powers that may or may not be immortal, that are attacking Gotham City, and that Nightwing might be one of them or not. We don't know. But this story, apparently, and all in each book, the Batman character is fighting a Talon, which is a super assassin mind wipe guy. And the new book is called Talon. Apparently one assassin survives and is trying to have a normal life, but he can't because he's tied in with Batman. Huh. Yeah. So, I mean, that one looks kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's one called A Sword of Sorcery, which is an anthology book. The first half of each issue is going to be about Amethyst, the Princess of Gemworld, which is a character from the 1980s that they're bringing back into continuity. That's not really the big thing. The big thing is that it's being written by Christy Marks, who created and wrote the majority of Gem and the Holograms.
And here's an interesting tidbit. Also wrote the two Sierra games, Conquest of Camelot and Conquest of the Longbow, which are both pretty neat.
Good,
old
cool
adventure games.
Oh, okay, yeah. No, now I remember.
Just
yeah,
looked her up on Facebook the other night.
No. Not Facebook,
not
just
Facebook,
the internet.
Wikipedia's what I meant.
Yeah.
Why is it Facebook?
Because the name sounded familiar. Because I thought she was the lady that wrote those games, and she was.
Yeah. Huh. Interesting. Very interesting.
One's the King Arthur, you're King Arthur, and you gotta do something, and the other one's like a Robin Hood simulation.
Okay.
Played that for a while.
Yeah.
I don't know why I stopped. I think I got confused. It got confusing.
That happens with the old Sierra games. Yeah. Like, what do I do? Oh, I died. Yeah. Gonna start all over again.
But no, so that one's actually looking pretty good. The other half of those issues are gonna have different, like, magic-y magic stories. Like, this first one's gonna have Beowulf and Grendel.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. But it's like set in the future. Because it's DC Comics. Yeah, it's actually not bad. There's one called Phantom Stranger, which I'm really excited about. Phantom Stranger is a really cool character, and it's looking like it's going to be tying in directly to the Justice League stories, which is cool. Problem is, it's being written by a guy named Dan DiDio, who was the editor-in-chief for many, many years for DC, and any book that he touches ends in six issues. He wrote OMAC, the one that just ended here. He used to be a halfway decent writer, but man, yeah, like I said, every book he touches ends quickly because they're not very good. And the last one is called Team 7, which is set in the past, but not so far in the past, where they still thought Superman was a bad guy. So they put together a team of assassins to hunt Superman, comprising of Steve Trevor, who is a Wonder Woman supporting character.
Oh, yeah, I know that.
Yeah. Grifter, who has his own book that is being written by Rob Liefeld and is terrible.
Naturally.
The non-fat Amanda Waller. And along with some others, Deathstroke, who has his own solo book and is terrible. I have no interest in that book. None.
It sounds bad.
Yeah.
I'm still mad about Amanda Waller.
I am too. You know, they didn't need to make her, you know, a supermodel. They didn't. It didn't need to happen.
Well, it's comics, and every female character has to be sexy, or what's the
one to bang her?
Oh man, that's just the wrong way of thinking. Honestly, that's just didn't have to happen like that. But whatever. So on to the next topic. You want to talk about this Andromeda thing with Kickstarter?
Sure. So, you know, there was a big Kickstarter boom there for a while when Tim Schafer did his Kickstarter for an unnamed adventure game that made like $300 billion.
Yeah.
And then everybody who used to make adventure games back in the day.
Hey, give me some of that money.
Yeah, so I could get in on that. And it seems like things have started to fatigue and less people want to give money to Kickstarters now. But there was still this one by the guys who made Space Quest, which is the classic Sierra game, like King's Quest and Police Quest, and it was part of that bunch of games. Mm-hmm. And their Kickstarter was dangerously close to not succeeding.
Really?
Which is a super shame, because it's a really good project, and they had so many awards. Their award tier was insane. And they had so much concept art and like a playable demo of the game that you could play.
Wow.
You know, before you pledged, and they didn't make their goal till like the last day.
Wow.
And I mean, it was like a $500,000 goal, so it was kind of steep, but still, that thing should have filled up within a couple days.
Right.
I mean, they obviously knew what they were doing. They have a good product that they're working on, and they wanted the fans to have all kinds of great pledge items that they could get. And I have no idea why it took that long. And I was really worried that, like, that good of a project was going to get left in the dust. Just because people had already given, you know, all their money to Tim Schafer.
Yeah, right.
I mean, I love the guy, and his games are great. He didn't need $3 million to make that game. Their goal was, like, $400,000.
Yeah. I mean, what's he going to do with all that money?
Make a game.
Yeah, now there's going to be full voice acting and in different languages, and maybe the graphics will be better or something.
That doesn't sound like $3 million to me.
Yeah, but he didn't even have a plan either. He didn't even say what it was going to be. He's just like, I'm going to make a game. Yeah.
Give me some money.
And whereas these guys had, they're like, this is the game we're going to make.
Wow. Well, see, they should have just come at it with, you know, we're making a game, whatever, here you go. Your wallet's out, yeah, guys. Yeah.
Or the Leisure Suit Larry guy.
Yeah.
He is just remaking the first game, and that got funded real quick. I'm like, really? You guys are going to pay a bunch of money for a guy to make the same game again, and these guys who are making an actually new game barely make their goal.
Well, yeah, and you know what? I think you hit the nail on the head. I think it's Kickstarter fatigue. Because, I mean, I know I burned pretty hot and heavy on it there for a while. I think that, I don't know. I think Kickstarter was better when not as many people were using it.
Yeah, or when people, not as many people knew about. No, that's not. Yeah, it got. There were so many dumb projects there for a while. Yeah, like it, that guy, pay me to play with Legos guy.
Oh, that guy. Yeah, that guy. Well, there was one that was a out and out scam on there. I don't have any of the stuff on me at the moment, but it was like an out and out scam where some Scandinavian company, a guy, took a bunch of screenshots from different games that were never made and like put them up and like copied the achievements tier from some other game that was trying to be funded. And I mean, luckily it got shut down within like 6 hours.
Yeah.
Cause Kickstarter places that stuff pretty close, but I mean, you're going to start to see more and more people start scamming on it. And between people scamming, people getting burnt, people overextending themselves with Kickstarter. Because, you know, you go on there and you say, okay, yeah, I'll flip $5 to this, $5 to that. Next thing you know, they all succeed and you're out $50.
Yeah.
And, you know, if everyone is doing a Kickstarter, then what's the point?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think people need to just pay more attention to what they're paying for.
Yeah.
Because I think Kickstarter is a great tool and it's amazing. It's an amazing thing to have. But don't just throw your money around on it.
Like, yeah. Yeah.
Give your money to the projects that actually deserve it.
Right.
Something that you really believe in.
Yeah. Support quality. Yeah. That's all it is. Just support quality.
It takes more than all. That's a neat idea. Don't actually look at what they have.
Like, yeah.
That other good. Have you seen that Zombie Playground one?
No, I haven't seen that one.
It's for a game that it's about kids fighting zombies in a school.
Okay.
And it looks really good. They had character models and test videos, and it was actually based on a piece of art that was viral. I hate saying viral, but it was being passed around the internet, a lot of these kids fighting zombies, and it went around under the name Left 4 Dead Kids, because that's what it kind of looked like.
Yeah.
But that was originally concept art for this game that they're making. Oh, wow.
Cool.
And that one deserves some money. It looks good.
Right.
And I don't want to say that the Leisure Suit Larry guy didn't deserve the money for his, but I wish it was a new game and not a remake. It just seems dumb.
Yeah, that seems like a ripoff more than anything.
Plus, that game was already remade once in the 90s. But
yeah, right.
No, I don't want to see people get uninterested in Kickstarter either. That would be upsetting.
Yeah.
Oh, movies. There's been a lot of new movies being announced, like Wreck-It Ralph, that looks really, really good.
John C. Reilly?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can't go wrong with him. I can't think of a movie that had him in it that I didn't like. I'm sure there is one. But
yeah. But no, Wreck-It Ralph looks really good. It's really shaping up to be like this generation's Roger Rabbit. I mean,
all those characters though in the trailer.
Yeah, and they're like the actual characters and not like...
It's not just like a cameo.
And not like rip-off characters.
Yeah.
Like Zangief, and he's like a Russian cow wrestler. Actually, that sounds pretty badass.
Next game, Cody.
Yeah. King Browser.
Yeah.
The ghost from Pac-Man. Now it just sounds like Steve Brule.
Which is appropriate since John C. Reilly's in this.
Who do you think was the first guy to get the highest points in Pac-Man? Some kind of hunk who played video games. Video games. Great video games.
Video games, there it is, yeah. Wreck-It Ralph looks really good. Although, you know, it's just a Disney. It's not a Disney Pixar.
But I think there's obviously some mingling.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah, I'm sure there is. Yeah. That's cool.
That's what Disney needed, I think, was Pixar.
As good as Tangled was.
Yeah.
It'll probably be pretty good. Tangled was amazing, which is almost embarrassing to say, but it was a damn good movie.
Yeah, it was. It really was. But some of the other movies coming out, we did a post on some trailers the other day, and, you know, I'm really looking forward to Django Unchained.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That looks really good.
I'm always looking forward to any Tarantino movie.
Yeah. I mean, I will say the trailer, it just, there's nothing special to it. I mean, it just looks like a Tarantino Western, which is fine. I mean, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of stuff that can't be shown in the, in the trailers that are in the film. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm cautiously optimistic about Jamie Foxx.
He was in it.
He's Django. He's the main guy. It's him and Christoph Waltz as the two. Christoph Waltz is going to be great. He's going to be great. But Jamie Foxx, he's about 50-50 with me. I mean, he was in Ray, which is great. He was also in Stealth, which was not. So I don't know. I mean, the role was originally pitched to Will Smith.
And he didn't take it. He didn't take a Tarantino movie role.
Probably family values.
Yeah, probably not family friendly enough.
I gotta go do Hancock 2.
Electric Handaloo.
Handaloo.
Even Hancock 2, even more Hancockier.
Hancock 2, one in both hands.
Oh. All right.
Yeah. Yep. Killed it.
Yeah. I couldn't resist. It was too good. I couldn't let it go. So there's your cock joke for the episode.
Yep. Let's see here. I also put up one for Skyfall, which I don't really have a whole lot to say on it, except by the trailer, it looks the most James Bond-like of all of the Daniel Craig James Bond films.
I haven't seen any of the Daniel Craig ones.
I've seen them, and I mean, they're more like the British Bourne movies. Yeah. I mean, they really took it way out to left field with some of the stuff. But this one looks the most Bondy of the bunch. The one thing I've heard, and I'm not happy about, like, I guess 40% of the money's budget has come from advertising. So everything's labels and stuff. And the thing, and you know, I'm okay with that every once in a while. You know, you're driving through and you see he's driving his Audi around and you see the Audi logo on the car and, you know, not a big deal. Thing that I am a little bugged about is instead of a martini shaken, not stirred, he asks the bartenders for Heinekens.
Oh, God.
That's awful. That's like he's known for.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. But that's...
It just makes me think of Mad Men when he's testing out those Heinekens on his... When Don's testing out those Heinekens on his wife because he knew he'd pick the green bottles. And they'd originally marketed Heineken towards women. And now James Bond is drinking Heineken exclusively.
Yeah, yeah. Very weird. But yeah, but no, Skyfall looks okay. It looks all right. I mean, it's...
I like it when James Bond gets... I like silly James Bond, like submarine car.
Well, then you're not going to like any of the any of the Daniel Craig ones. But yeah. And God, for the life of me, I can't remember what that fourth trailer was that I put up. It was...
I just looked at it today.
Oh, man. It wasn't a Batman trailer. It was good, whatever it was. Couldn't have been that good. Yeah. You know what? I'm going to get up and look on the computer. We'll cut all this dead air out. So after looking it up, the fourth trailer that we put up was Expendables 2, which looks like about the same as Expendables 1. Looks good. Just, you know, a bunch of old action stars blowing stuff up. Chuck Norris was in it, so that's pretty cool.
I never saw the first one because I was so mad at it for beating Scott Pilgrim at the box office. Oh,
yeah, yeah.
Jake wants to be involved.
Oh, Jakey. Poor dog. There we go. You okay? You're gonna make it? Are you gonna make it?
Yeah, he's fine. He's...
Oh, man. So, with that...
A lot to edit out.
Yep, a lot to edit out. All right, so I guess we're going to take a break here, and we'll come back with some PXT mailbag, and that's it.
picture yourself
in a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies. Somebody calls you. You answer quite slowly. A girl with kaleidoscope eyes. Cellophane flowers of yellow and green towering over your head. Look for the girl with a sun in her eyes. And she's gone! She's gone. She's gone. She's gone.
All right, we're back, and you've heard the song, so you know that it's time for the PXT mailbag.
Yep, we're dipping into the old mailbag again.
Yep.
See what our fans have to say.
Yeah, Cody, looks like you got one over there.
Yes, I've already dipped into the mailbag, and I'm holding the mail as we speak. Let me start reading it, I suppose. It's from a Mrs. Ednadora Benini.
Benini.
Benini?
Benene?
Benene.
Benene. Benene. Nice.
And the subject is from Miss Eleanor Benene. I'm just going to say Benene.
Yeah, just say it. Yeah. It's all right.
Greetings in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. With due respect and humanity, well, I'm glad that it's a person. It's a
yeah,
human
right.
person.
Yes.
I was compelled to write to you under a humanitarian ground. I am suffering from a long-time cancer.
Oh, man, that's the worst kind of cancer, long times.
Well, it's capitalized, so maybe she's being bothered by someone with the astrological sign of cancer.
Maybe. That could be. That could be.
From all indication, my condition is really deteriorating. According to my doctors, the stage has gotten to a very bad stage. This money came as a result of a paycheck contract between my husband and a Russian firm.
Wait a minute. When did this money come from?
Oh, no, a payback contract. It came from Russians.
But I mean, it's just like out of the blue, she starts talking about money. It's like, oh, I'm dying of long-time cancer.
It's money.
I have money. All right, sorry. Sorry to interrupt. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I didn't notice that. It does come out of nowhere. Just all of a sudden, it's money.
Yeah.
I'll go back to the letter. I was married to late Dr. Ardwa Benene, a contractor who worked with oil company for 52 years before he died in the year 2009, he died after a cardiac arteries operation.
Okay, so let me stop you there for a second again. So he's a doctor who's also a contractor.
For an oil company.
For an oil company that's been working for over 50 years.
He's a busy man.
Okay, I just want to make that clear.
He obviously worked at this oil company while he was going to school to be a doctor.
He's Dr. Oil.
Dr. Oil. Dr. Big Oil.
Yes.
When my late husband was alive, he deposited the sum of $4,500,000 and no cents in a bank in Abidjan, and the money is still there.
No way.
What are you going to do with all this money? Recently, my doctor told me about my condition due to my cancer problem and having known my condition. That's quite a sentence. I have decided to handle over this money to an honest, in all caps, person. That's us.
Oh, okay.
We're very honest.
That's us.
That will utilize this fund for the services of mankind, helping the motherless, helping the motherless homes, orphans, widows, as desired by my late husband when he was alive. I took this decision because I don't have any children to inherit this fund, and I don't want this money to be used unwisely.
So they're giving it to us.
Because we're charitable organization.
A PXT means honesty.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That kind of rhymes.
Yeah.
It's a new slogan. Yeah, new slogan. We're going to throw out the what? PXT means honesty. And the T will be capital in honesty.
Yes.
Write back to me as soon as possible, because any delay in your reply will give me opportunity to look for another person for the same purpose. Is that like a threat?
I think she's threatening us.
As soon as I receive your reply, I shall give you other informations, ", on how you can receive this money from the bank. I will be glad to hear from you soon. May God bless and keep us. Yours, Miss Ednadora Benene.
Wow, that is a hell of a email.
Is our name like on some list of charities somewhere?
And we must. It must be. I mean, well, we're on the nice guy list.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We are a non-profit.
Yes.
As of right now.
In fact, we are a negative profit.
Yeah.
But hey, thank you for listening. Thank you for checking out the site and checking out the show, Miss Benene.
Thanks for your generous donation of $4 million.
Yeah.
You know, we keep getting these emails about getting money, and we haven't seen any of it.
I know. What? I don't understand.
I want to be rich. I want to be mad rich. Where's my free money? So, yeah, thanks. Thanks for listening and sending us. That's, well, yeah, I was getting there. To. I was setting it up.
I wasn't sure. Right. It sounded like you were just going to end it.
Yeah, that's it. Over.
Show done.
Show done.
Get the fuck out of here. Get out of my house. Hey, guys. Get the fuck out of my office. Oh, no, Jake. Not you.
Oh. Oh,
poor Jake.
All right, we got to wrap it up so we can go and make Jake feel better about himself.
He's a fragile dog. Anyway, thanks for listening. Bye. No. Thanks for listening, everybody, to the Pizzacast, the official podcast of Pizza Extreme Team.
If you haven't already, subscribe to the podcast.
Yeah, on iTunes. You can follow us on Twitter at Pizza Extreme Team. You can like us on Facebook.
You
did. At facebook.com/PizzaExtremeTeam. We are 4 away from being able to see our stats, guys. Then we'll shut up about the Facebook page.
Start pushing something else on
it. That's right. Yeah, that's right. So
Twitter at Pizza Extreme Team.
I just said that.
Did you? I'm not listening. We'll do it.
All right, awesome. All right, this is falling apart, guys. Yeah. So for Pizza Extreme Team, I am Sam.
Wait, I had something I wanted to say.
Okay.
Something they should do on the website. Oh, the contest.
Yeah, the contest.
There's still a copy of Cthulhu Saves the World up for grabs if you send us a legitimate email. Still. It's been 3 episodes in.
Yeah.
Nobody's claimed it. So if you want a free copy of a really great game, send us an email. So that's it, everybody. Thanks for listening. Pizza out.
You guys never announce your guys' names.
Oh.
Never mind.
We never did it at the beginning either. They know. They know who we are.
Sleepy, and there is no place I'm going to. Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me.
In the jingle jangle morning, I'll come following you.
Take me on a trip on your magic swirling ship. My senses have been stripped. My hands can't feel to grip. My toes too numb to step. Wait only for my boot heels to be wandering. Ready to go anywhere. I'm ready for to fade into my own parade. Cast your dancing spell my way. I promise to go under it. I'm not sleepy and there is no place I'm going to. In the jingle, jangle morning, I'll come following you. Hey.